In Latin America, hundreds of thousands of people have died from the so-called war on drugs, and tens of thousands still remain forcibly disappeared. The power of cartels is not waning, and many still feel the dire effects of failed counter-drug policies. It's now been more than half a century since U.S. President Nixon started the war on drugs, and the U.S. poured billions of dollars into combating the transnational drug trade. The result? Ordinary people throughout Latin America felt the brunt of the violence. And in the U.S., black and brown communities suffered the most from punitive counter-drug policies. So is this really a war on drugs, or is it a war for control and profit? Joining us to discuss this are renowned Mexican investigative journalist Anabel Hernandez, and author of several books, including Narcoland, The Mexican Drug Lords and Their Godfathers, and Maria McFarland Sanchez-Moreno, senior legal advisor at Human Rights Watch, focusing on the Americas, U.S., and Canada. She's also the author of There Are No Dead Here, a story of murder and denial in Colombia. Thank you both for joining me on Upfront. Anabel, I'm going to start with you. Back in 2006, Mexico's former president, Felipe Calderón, launched a U.S.-backed war on drugs in the country, dispatching the army and federal police to combat drug violence. But it actually had the opposite effect. Violence increased, and since then, more than 300,000 people have been killed, and more than 90,000 people have been registered as forcibly disappeared. Despite state initiatives to supposedly stop the drug war and billions of dollars in U.S. aid, why does the violence continue?
Well, really, it's a very complex explanation. But for me, there are four main issues that cause that the tragedy in Mexico is still being there. One is that the major, the principal drug cartel, Sinaloa cartel, is still very powerful, not just in Mexico, also in all the American continent and in other parts of the world. And of course, the cartel is still impune. Second, that unfortunately, the cartel still have many ties, strong ties, with the parts of the Mexican government. I mean, the military, the federal police, many parts of the government in Mexico still connected with the cartel. The third issue is that, you know, even with the COVID issue, the demand of drugs in all the world is more than ever. And the fourth issue is, of course, that we are talking about a global problem. It's not a local issue in Mexico. In Mexico, you can see the deaths, the tragedy, but the responsibility is in all the world.
Maria, let me turn to you, because in Colombia, we're seeing an interesting development as well. The drug cartels don't have as much power as they did in the 1980s, 1990s, but Colombia is still the world's biggest producer of cocaine. Drug trafficking has had just a devastating impact on the population for decades, and you have researched the connection between drug traffickers in Colombia and very high levels of government. How deep is state involvement in the drug trade in Colombia?
So the pattern that you see in Colombia is in many ways very similar to what you see in Mexico, in Afghanistan, and many other countries, which is that prohibition, right? This war on drugs, heavy-handed enforcement, extradite, arrest, kill drug traffickers approach, all it does is make the value, the price of drugs higher, right? And that fuels organized crime. So you have the drug business actively engaged in violence and very involved in corrupting public officials to protect themselves, to protect their drug corridors, to allow them to do all their business with impunity, to allow them to keep their wealth. And no matter how hard you try with the heavy-handed law enforcement approach, they're going to keep going.
Anabel, you've documented similarly in many ways state involvement in the drug trade at the highest levels of the Mexican government. You exposed how former President Calderón's head of public security was not only involved with the Sinaloa cartel, he was on the payroll of the Sinaloa cartel. So when the government says it's fighting the drug war. Is this just a cover? Is this complete dishonesty? Why would the state be protecting these cartels?
Well, as I already explained, we are talking about a global issue. Yes, in Mexico, we know, because this is a fact, that the Mexican government, the Mexican system, is very corrupted. We have a lot of examples of that. But what about the rest of the world? What about United States? You know, is the biggest consumer of drugs in the world. What about Europe? What about Asia? I mean, because the drugs don't just stay in Mexico or Colombia, and that's the end of the story. For the drug cartels to be able to traffic these tons of drugs through the world, they need corrupted connections, not just in Mexico, not just in Colombia, also in Germany, in, you know, in Amsterdam, in Paris, in New York. So we are talking about that in this war on drugs, the corruption is everywhere, because we are talking about the profits of this dirty business create millions of dollars.
That's a great point. And Maria, what Annabelle's saying is very important, right? So many people stand to benefit from the war on drugs, or the enterprise that's connected to the war on drugs. You have mm-hmm. security contractors, you have banks that launder money to corrupt politicians. This can't be isolated to one entity, to one state, to one person. In your view, who stands to benefit the most from the war on drugs?
I mean, I think that organized crime ultimately stands to benefit the most, because it makes them so powerful and so wealthy. Organized crime, plus all of their cronies in the state. And as Anabel pointed out, it's not just in Mexico or in Colombia that you're looking at issues. So yes, it's those networks. It's not the growers, for example, who often get targeted, or the people who get prosecuted in the United States for low-level sales. And certainly not the people who get prosecuted for using drugs.
Right. You
know, all of those groups of people stand to lose, right? People, overwhelmingly low-income, black and brown people in the United States and in Mexico and in Colombia end up prosecuted, imprisoned for drug offenses in this, you know, war on drugs push. And that achieves nothing except destroy their lives.
Maria, I want to take a step back and talk a little bit about sort of the United States getting involved in the war on drugs in Latin American countries, mm-hmm. right? There had to be a geopolitical logic, a geopolitical reasoning for it. Why does the United States invest itself? Why does it make that decision to invest itself? Was it a new form of sort of control, so to speak?
You know, the U.S.'s interests in fighting drug trafficking, though, are very hard to pin down, in the sense that Plan Colombia money that the U.S. then invested in, you know, billions of dollars in Colombia starting in the late 90s, early 2000s, this was Bill Clinton's initiative, that money was mainly used to go after the FARC guerrillas. They said it was to fight drug trafficking, but very little of it was focused on going after the paramilitaries, who were the biggest drug traffickers at the time, and most of it was used to go after the FARC. So the motivations get very murky, because what you end up with is a government that is, you know, very connected to the paramilitaries in the early 2000s, going after the FARC. So the U.S. seemed to be backing one group of drug traffickers against another.
Annabel, governments, if they're continuing business as usual in their approach to the drug war, you know, bolstering security forces with U.S. funding, deploying militaries, fueling corruption, criminalizing victims, what can we do? What would be a more effective and humanitarian approach to really ending a war on drugs, if that's at all possible?
Well, it's a complicated question, you know, because in my point of view, really had never exist one real war against drugs. What, you know, I have been investigating the drug cartels in Mexico, also the connection of these cartels with other countries, in a specific way with the United States. You know, I got information inside one source that used to work with the Sinaloa cartel, and even this source told me, revealed me how some parts of the U.S. government start to have some relation, if you want to see what call it like that, with the members of the Sinaloa cartel. So what I have understand is that doesn't exist a war against drugs, exists a war to try to control, to administer the business. I think the United States government have been a very, how can I say it, a double face about these issues. Yeah. Because they call it a war against drugs, but I think in the deep, they don't want to destroy the business. They want to administer the business. And of course, this purpose to manage and not destroy the business create a lot of victims. The main of the victims are in countries like Colombia, like Mexico, like Central America. I mean, we have to start to talk about these issues with another language. This is an international issue. All the countries should do a big plan how to approach to this problem. I mean, we have to just try to left away the old speech about this issue and start to talk about this in a new way.
Maria, Annabelle, thank you so much for joining me. Everybody, that is our show. Upfront, we'll be back next week.